Next, the battle against cancer, specifically gynecological cancers. Gwen died on Monday at the age of 61 after her fight with endometrial cancer, also referred to as uterine cancer. It is one of several gynecological cancers women face that sometimes get less attention. More than 50,000 women in the U.S. are diagnosed with uterine cancer each year, and more than 9,300 die from it. Ovarian cancer is better known. About 20,000 women are diagnosed each year, and more than 14,000 die from it annually. Cervical cancer's death rate has dropped dramatically. Roughly 12,000 are diagnosed with it annually. More than 4,000 die from it. We're not focused on Gwen's particular case tonight, but we wanted to take this moment to look at the latest efforts to diagnose and treat these cancers. Dr. Karen Liu is chair of gynecologic oncology at MD Anderson Cancer Center in Houston. And Dr. Angela Marshall is an advisor to the Black Women's Health Imperative. She's a women's health specialist in Maryland. Dr. Liu, now that we've set the table a little bit, let's add a little context to this. In relation to other cancers, how prevalent are these?
So altogether, as you said, almost 100,000 women this year will be diagnosed with a gynecologic cancer. And importantly, with uterine cancer, it's on the rise.
And put that in perspective, compared to there's a horrible reality in the cancer marketplace that some cancers get more attention than others, and then the more attention they get, the more research funding they get as well. So how do these cancers compete and fare when we think about all the other cancers that are out there?
There definitely is less attention, even though there's such a high number of women with these cancers. And I think the breast cancer community has done a fantastic job about demystifying and being open about talking about breast cancer, about risk factors, about what early signs are. And I think when we're talking about gynecologic cancers, so that's cancer of the uterus, the cervix, and the ovaries, we're a little bit more, maybe perhaps embarrassed to talk about it, and that goes towards individual women and the impact that that may have in terms of them thinking about symptoms that they may have, and also kind of on a broader scale in terms of really garnering interest and increasing research funding for the diseases.
Dr. Marshall, I've heard them described as below the belt cancers. Is there a stigma attached with discussing this openly compared to, say, breast cancer, which societally we seem to have no problem talking about?
I think there is, but I think more importantly, I think this is a good time to talk about the importance of women and self-care. And by self-care, I mean the importance of getting screening tests. And screening tests are tests that we do when people are having no symptoms. So when we do mammograms, you know, we're screening for breast cancer in women who have no symptoms. However, for uterine and for ovarian cancer, we don't have adequate screening tests for those. So those are tests that rely on women reporting symptoms before we do any kind of workup. And so I think it's important to get the word out. I think education is extremely important. People need to know what the symptoms are, and they need to know what tests to be requesting from their healthcare providers.
Dr. Liu, is there a gap in women seeing symptoms but not necessarily reporting them or not even knowing that they're symptoms?
I think there's two gaps. I think there's a gap where women don't know that there are early symptoms of these cancers and so don't recognize them. And then there's also a gap when they report these symptoms. Sometimes they can be nonspecific. And certainly with ovarian cancer, women will present with bloating or their bellies will be bigger, very nonspecific pain. And sometimes physicians will dismiss these symptoms and not fully work up and think about ovarian cancer or other gynecologic cancers as a cause.
Dr. Marshall, I see you nodding your head in agreement here. Is this also the case, and does it disproportionately affect women of color or in the African American community?
It does, and I think specifically for African American women, it's important to have healthcare providers that we trust, because there's historically been some mistrust in the African American community. It's also important to have good access to healthcare, and it's important for us to have access to health insurance plans that aren't high deductibles. You know, some women are forced with making a decision to put food on the table versus paying for expensive diagnostic testing, and so sometimes it boils down to an economic issue.
So sometimes it's the infrastructure that's influencing whether or not they get the care.
Exactly.
Dr. Liu, if a patient gets one of these diagnoses, What should they start thinking about? How should they look at this?
That's a great question. You know, there's so much information available on the internet, and we say that's good and bad. But I do overall think it's important for women to arm themselves with information when they go seek health care. I think the second thing is to really seek a specialist. There are, we are specialists, gynecologic oncologists, who focus on treating these cancers. And it's really important that women who are diagnosed with uterine cancer, ovarian cancer, cervix cancer, have a specialist who can take care of them.
Dr. Marshall, what about those cases where if you don't have the expertise of a Dr. Liu, you don't live in Houston, you don't live in a major cancer center or medical center, how hard is it for someone to lobby basically for themselves or advocate to try to get that extra level of care and expertise?
I think it starts with having a healthcare provider that you trust. And so often we don't, especially among African Americans. And so I think your primary care doctor is a great resource, and I think you should be an advocate for yourself and help have them help you with the referrals to the specialists.
Dr. Liu, where does the research stand in all of this, considering, especially even including pharmaceutical companies, because they're crucial in the treatment part?
Absolutely. Research is really important, and it's a great time now. There's a lot of exciting research going on. So I like to think about it for early stage cancers. We're really focusing on minimizing treatment in some ways. So we're seeing younger women who are diagnosed with uterine cancer. Uterine cancer is very tightly linked to obesity. So as we see an obesity epidemic, we're seeing more and more younger women, women in their 40s, sometimes even in their 30s, with uterine cancer. So we're thinking about, you know, can we think about treatments where we can preserve the uterus? Even with cervix cancer, we're thinking about, are there options for women to be able to have the option of childbearing. So that's for early stage. For later stage cancers, there's a lot of emphasis on understanding the very basic molecular kind of DNA genes that contribute to the cancer cells. Once we understand that, we're able to bring in some of these new targeted therapies, immunotherapy. So it's an exciting time, but it requires resources. It requires women to be open to clinical trials, and I really want to stress that because I think that if we're going to make advances, and we need to, especially for women who have advanced stage disease, we're going to really need to encourage women to participate in clinical trials.
All right, Dr. Karen Liu, Dr. Angela Marshall, thank you for what might be the first of many conversations on this topic. Thank you very much.
Thank you.